There's a first time for everything, and it certainly couldn't be truer than it is today. Bears football for the first time in program history, receiving a visit from the Cardinals of the Catholic University of America. Welcome, folks, to the 2022 New England Bowl. Here at Swenson Field on the campus of Bridgewater State University, a brisk but beautiful-looking November day. Welcome to the Bears Sports Network here on BTV. I'm Matt Donahue.
And my name is David Souza.
David, both of these teams are kind of okay records, 6-4 both. They come in from two different conferences, the Bears, of course, in the MASCAC. Just won their final game of the regular season last Saturday in the Cranberry Bowl against Mass Maritime. CUA, meanwhile, in the new MAC coming in from a loss to Springfield College last week that would have sent them to the NCAA tournament, and they're going to be looking for revenge here today.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the first time Bridgewater has been in the New England Bowl since the 2016 versus Salve Regina, and this is the first time that the Catholic has been in at a bowl game at all since 2008. This is the first time they've been in the New England Bowl, so.
And it's also the
game.
And it's also the first time this year that Bridgewater State is going to be without two key parts of their ground game. Adam Couch and William Poynter, the running backs who see the most yardage by far in the running game for this Bears squad, are both out today. Isaiah Wright is going to get the start at running back for the Bears. How do you think this is going to affect the way that James Cahoon, the starting quarterback, approaches the run game, particularly as compared to the passing game?
I think he'll start taking off more as a quarterback. He has done that a lot more recently as the season has gone on and his college career has gone on. He likes to run more than he had in the past. So I think he'll probably run a little bit more today, maybe a little more the 9 QB runs that we haven't really called yet. You know, it's a special game. You got to pull all the plays you have. All the plays in the playbook are open today.
Catholic will receive in the first half.
Bears have won the toss and deferred. Cardinals are going to start on offense here this afternoon. Cahoon, as you mentioned, you talk about his running game. It's been a bit of a checkered go of it for him this year. He's gained 164 rushing yards and lost 105.
I believe a lot of those come off of sacks,
mm-hmm.
But you know, it shows he doesn't really run very often. It was always behind the line of scrimmage.
And it's going to be especially interesting to see how that compares against a Cardinals team. We were just talking about this before the broadcast, that spends most of the game in the air. National anthem, and we'll be right back with you. Kickoff coming soon, and the ball will belong first to the Cardinals and their senior quarterback, who took over something to the effect of mid-season, the Miami native Nico Casares, who got the starting job after an injury took down the original starter Madden Lowe.
Yeah, you know, Casares, it's an awesome story to read. He started the season as a third-string quarterback. He became a starter week 5 versus MIT in a 42-7 win. Threw for 448 yards and 5 touchdowns. And he earned, all the season, he's earned first-team New Mac All-Conference team.
And he's performed like it, almost 300 yards a game. He's 157 for 228 in the air, which again is where Catholic University spends most of its offensive time. He's thrown just four picks the entire season in six games played. Not so bad at all.
You know, like if you compare his stats to what Cahoon's done on the season, 2,409 yards, 22 touchdowns to seven interceptions, although he threw three last week, which for Cahoon, that's pretty, you know, that's like a black sheep sort of thing. He doesn't really do that very often.
And I hate to rain on your parade, but Casares has more yards per game, 299.7 on average per game compared to 240.9 for Cahoon. It's going to be a real quarterback battle out there today.
Absolutely. The game is underway.
That's a long kickoff for a touchback.
Shane Drake was a MASCAC first team for the Bears and had an awesome season. Won Player of the Week several times. Speaking of accolades, important mention because the Bears defense coming out, Steven Sylvia won MASCAC Defensive Player of the Year, so an awesome achievement for him.
Sylvia, who had an intense performance, certainly. Just last week against Mass Maritime in the Cranberry Bowl. CUA starting at their own 25. And there was some early movement there.
This could be a false start because they blow the play dead. Typically, if it's an offsides, it would be. They let the play go. Let's hear what the call is.
False start, offense, 5 yards.
Couldn't hear what was on, but it was a false start penalty, and it'd be 5 yards to start the game. 5 yard penalty.
A less than auspicious beginning.
It's a good
first and 15 from their own 20 for the Cardinals. Casares pass game immediately, airs it out, and missed his intended target. That was destined, at least in theory.
That's Malachi Hansen, who's a great kick returner for the team. One first team all-conference for the new MAC as a returner, but also had a great season in the air as well as a receiver.
Hansen, not typically in their depth chart for conventional offensive plays, and it's second and 15 for the Cardinals. Handoff this time, pickup of pretty much nothing.
It was a heavy run there, but I believe that was number 9, McCarty. We'll see here again. They parted the Red Seas for him, like, off the line. Did a great job blocking for him. That was an easy run.
Kevin Licciardi, one of the more local members of this Cardinals squad from East Greenwich, Rhode Island. He picks up just 2 on the carry, though. Third and 13. Trying to generate movement again, and somebody did.
It's going to be another false start.
Offense number 64. 5 yard penalty.
Oh. That's Javier Oliver.
It's a weird call on him because he won first team all new MAC. You know, this is a great player who's made one mistake and it could cost the drive pretty much for this team. Unless a big play happens here.
Senior lineman from Virginia sends him back 5. Third and 18. Casares looking for the pass game and traffic right through the hands. That was meant for Derek Akins, the tight end, but he didn't hit his mark.
Here's a pass again. It's thrown. Tries to go airborne as Akins, but could not come down with it. It almost could have found the hands of Jaron Alves there. Yeah.
Connor Gill punting, the junior from Westminster, Maryland. And Drew Donovan, the usual suspect, returning for the Bears.
Just nearly blocked. Not a great bounce there for the Catholic there.
You got to give him a little bit of slack. He's punting from his own end zone.
fair enough.
Tough go of it, and James Cahoon and company, Bears offense, setting up from within Cardinal territory.
Javaria. Senior showing his defense what to do. Had a great first drive. But I think what killed the Cardinals that first drive with penalties. 2 false starts on the first drive is not what we want to see. That's 10 yards you lost with no play being so they've no play.
James Cahoon is hungry for yards. Last week in the Cranberry Bowl, he broke his own single-season passing yardage record. He stands at 2,409, and he's not going to increase that on this carry here.
You mentioned the run game earlier. They're down Adam Couch, who's had an awesome season. They're down William Pointer, who's also had came in relief and has an awesome season as a backup. We see the running backs taking over. This is Isaiah Wright. He's played solid this year too. We mentioned Cahoon wanting yards. Cahoon is 1,375 yards away from being the all-time passing yards leader for the Bears, as well as 18 touchdowns coming into this game. So, see what he can do.
Wright picked up three on the carry there. Cahoon's going to hand it off to him again. And this time he's going to break right for another first down and a couple extra. When I say another first down, the first down of the game for either team.
And it's given off by the third string running back, Isaiah Wright.
Isaiah Wright, whose bag is usually kicks and punt returns, is really showing out in the ground game so far today.
Isaiah Wright just had a powerful run. He's a speedy guy. He got space on the outside and just took it for a first down.
First and 10 from the Cards 30. Cahoon, another handoff to Wright, but he can't get any real estate at all, and he's going to go down for a loss of a couple.
I believe the market has a loss of one. We got four to progress, but another excellent play. That's a good play for the defensive line. Isaiah Wright was able to break a tackle at first. So again, he sort of breaks off that first tackle and just sort of goes down for the second one. But it took two defenders to take him down. He's proven why he should be starting full-time for this team. Adam Couch will be graduated by next year, so who knows who will start for them.
Cahoon will pass this time. Easy one to Wright. And he's going to chew up most of the down, but not all.
So far this drive has been right. He's the guy they're leaning on today. You can see why. He's got speed. He's got agility. He's making his way down the field very slowly but effectively.
Now you can see why they put him on the ground game. He averages exactly 6 yards a rush, which is actually, if you can believe it, better than both Couch and Pointer's numbers. Third and four. Cahoon, another pass. Who else but Wright? But he gets mowed down promptly.
I believe this is going to bring up fourth and short. The question is, do you go for it? I believe they seem to be, as Cahoon stays put. Here's that pass again. But Wright probably a little bit behind where it should have been. But it's fourth down, fourth and three.
And Cahoon is still out there. They're going to try this one out. What the heck? Why not?
Nothing to lose except a football game.
Three away from the line to gain. Cahoon, no one near him. He's going to pass. Working through the pocket. He's going to run it himself for first down yardage and then some. And he's going to slide right at about the CUA 10, maybe a little before.
I mean, look at this play. It was broken down, excellent coverage, and he's just like, I'm just take off with it. Like I mentioned earlier, he might run a little bit more missing his two starting running backs, but that hasn't bothered Cahoon at all.
Cahoon makes something out of nothing, and it's first and 10 in the Cards red zone. Another handoff to Wright. He gets tripped up right at the line of scrimmage.
Right on the carry. Defense comes up big here as they blew up off the line and the coverage, the protection just wasn't there. Wright goes down.
Last time on this broadcast, I know we talked a lot about young guys in this Bridgewater State unit getting a chance to shine. Talk about Isaiah Wright, just a sophomore with this program out of Worcester, Mass. Came east and he's showing out with the Bears today.
This is the biggest game of his career so far.
He gets another handoff. Can't find the angle he was looking for. Got maybe one or two.
Couldn't exactly get much out of there, but he definitely had potential. The blocking was there until it breaks down as soon as he puts through. Block shedding off the defensive line. Very excellent.
Defensive stop. Courtesy of the linebacker, Michael Hopkins. And he forces the Bears into third and nine. Bridgewater State needing a really good conversion right here if they plan to get this thing anywhere near the end zone.
It needs to be in the end zone for it to be a conversion at this point.
Yeah, there's still a couple inches of leeway.
Probably,
if we really want to get semantic about it. Third and nine, Cahoon looking to pass, trying to slip out of the pocket again. And he does, but he's not going to get first down yardage.
Calhoun tried running the QB draw there, but unfortunately does not get the first down. But I think he's staying out there. They want to get a touchdown this drive, and the defense has found an answer so far to this run game. For the first half of this drive didn't go well for the defense. Now they're doing a little better.
Fourth and five. They're going to take a whack at it. Calhoun looking to air it out again. He's going to slip through and throws it incomplete.
So he just had to get rid of it there. But if it's fourth down, you got to at least try to find a target to throw to. He just sort of throws it to nobody. But it's better than doing that than risking injury. So I get it. I get what he's doing.
Bears come so close and yet so far. And CUA turns them over on downs.
Well, the Bears, they have another defensive stop like they had the first drive. This could be very disastrous for the Cardinals today.
You can tell just looking at the way Calhoun has executed so far today, relying solely on Wright, you can tell he's a little bit lost without those two ground game stalwarts, Couch and Pointer, working alongside him today. Casares and company back out for the Cards. He's going to hand off.
Again, some more good protection, but better block shedding here by the Bears. It's sort of a hole open for him, and then eventually just gets closed down from all sides. Number
26, Coletti on the carry. Just about 2 yards, and they belong to Jared Coletti, the running back. Coletti from Pennsylvania. Third and eight. Another handoff. That one also to Coletti, but he doesn't pick up much, if anything.
Another very promising run there by Coletti, going off to the left tackle. But it was a tackle made by Brandon Albert to prevent that play. Brandon Albert having an excellent season at first team MASCAC, conference team.
Third and six. Coletti picked up just a couple. Interesting to see them keep it on the ground so early for a team that usually passes. This time Casares probably heard me. Airs that one out. What a pass for first down and some extra.
Did the ball come out at the end?
Bears think it did. That was initially a pretty sweet looking shot to Anthony Giordano. Bears thought the ball came out and that they recovered, but doesn't look like it.
Referees are saying he's down by contact, and so he is. Yeah, I believe he is down by contact. Good call there by the referees.
Anthony Giordano with his 25th reception of the year. Another Pennsylvanian. Keystone State getting it done on this drive for the Cardinals. Play action. Another shot.
It's a catch by Preston Jeffrey, who's also had a great season. It was with 7 touchdowns in the year. It was a very powerful tackle going down there. But I believe that is number 19 for the Bears.
Preston Jeffrey averages 72 and a half yards in the air per game. Certainly picked up a chunk of that on that one. Fresh set of downs right at the 50. Casares side pass. And not much real estate at all for Jared Coletti.
Yeah, Coletti getting nothing there because the defense, the protection sort of breaks down, and the screen pass doesn't really work out that well for him, and he gets taken out.
Coletti, if you can believe it, the running back, averages 23.8 yards in the air per game. He does see some passes from time to time.
Yeah, they definitely have a 2 running back backfield always with Coletti and Lucchiardi.
Coletti lost a yard on that one, 2nd and 11. Pass is complete.
It's Hanson again, the returner, but also their second best receiver on this team. Another screen pass. They're trying to get the ball out quick and get the ball to players who can make plays with it.
Malachi Hanson from Philadelphia picks up 6 on the play. 3rd and 5 from the Bears 45, and the Cards have finally worked it into Bridgewater territory for the first time today. Another pass again to Giordano, and he's going to move the chains.
This offense is a lot of screen passes. It's easy throws for Casares, but these players are able to make great plays, and here we see again, it's number three, I believe, making a great play.
Giordano picked up nine. Line of scrimmage will be Bridgewater State's 36. Just about 5 minutes to go in the first quarter. Still scoreless here at Swenson. Casares the handoff. That one again to Coletti. And he picks up about three. Maybe four.
The Cardinals are doing a great job of establishing the run. You know, the run is where your plays are going to happen. You can trick the defense on play action, or you can run the ball down their throat all day, and they won't be able to do much about it. It's easy to get turnovers when you're passing, so keep the ball safe, ball on the ground is a good idea.
They're going to give him 4 yards on that carry. Second and six. Casares passes, and that's a stop for a loss.
But call that no gain there. But again, just it's sniffed out by the defense because they keep running screen passes. The defense is able to answer them.
And it was a big takedown there on the play by Souza, who's been a real defensive powerhouse for the Bears. Solid TFL there. Third and nine for the Cardinals. Casares is looking for some more momentum. Trying to air it out, puts it off to the side instead. Hits Coletti, and he's taken down even further back.
Coletti started running backwards, so forward progress only counts as he goes back, and then it gets taken down, and that's where he stopped before a loss. But excellent defensive play there for the Bears. And I believe that's going to be number two for the Bears on defense. It is deliver Ibrahimi, the safety, making a play there.
Fourth and 13, and Casares is not cowed. Card's offense gonna look for another passing play. Casares stuck up, airing it out. Nearly, yes it is. How about Souza with the INT?
Zachary Souza with the deflection INT. I believe he had two last week.
Yes indeed.
There's another one this week. An excellent play there by Souza to keep his eyes on the ball. It was Jerry Niles, I believe, who gets his hands on initially, but he can't come down with it. But Souza, who does, their numbers are just switched. But that was a great play for both of them.
Same execution, great tip by Alves, great finish by Souza, and Bridgewater State takes over at their own 38. An expertly crafted turnover. And it looked like they generated some movement from the CUA defense.
Offense number 74.
Oh no.
They got a penalty, first down.
I stand corrected. They're going to say the guilty party was in fact the Bears. That flag belongs to Lookman Belogan, the freshman from Randolph. False start on Bridgewater State, and they're going to step back a couple.
I believe it's possibly the first penalty on Bridgewater of the day. The false start has been happening a lot for both of these teams.
Looked like I saw some movement on the CUA defense as well, but this time they got the first guy instead of the second.
It was a lateral shift, so it was not really a big deal.
Play action. Cahoon trying to rush it, passes it complete.
Nocera reaching for the first down.
Michael Nocera, one of his usual air targets.
And just the last week, Nocera has taken over Kyle Torres as the leading receiver for this team in yards and touchdowns.
They're going to call him just short of the line to gain. He picked up 14 on the play. Second and one for Bridgewater State, but still an admirable move. Cahoon the handoff to Wright, going to break through. He's got the first down and then some. He's going to keep on rolling along the right sideline, and he's finally escorted out of bounds by Noah Miller.
What a play by Wright there. But credit to the offensive line to just get that space for him, but he makes a guy miss and just keeps running down the sideline. Excellent play there by Wright.
Isaiah Wright, as we mentioned, usually a kick and punt returner, is starting at running back today, and he's acting like it too.
Oh, awesome run there.
Handoff this time, breaking through for a whole lot of extra. Greg Dimitri with his first touch of the day.
It's just that's again, that's the offensive line up front doing a great job of blocking for him, and he just finds a way to get right down for another first down. His first carry of the game is a first down. That's an excellent percentage you want to have. One for one.
Under 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. Still scoreless, but Bears have poked their way back into the Cards red zone. Play action, deep one, pass incomplete. That one was meant for Kopecky.
Kopecky's had a great season, both receiving and even rushing. Yeah, he had two touchdowns just a few weeks ago out of Wildcat formation, but could not come down with the ball there. Kind of just a get the ball away play.
Second and 10. Cahoon waiting for his marching orders from the sideline, and it looks like he's got him. In formation with Wright right next to him. Cahoon's still awaiting instructions. Play clock is at 10. Motion man Nocera. Play action, looking for a shot right to the end zone, incomplete, and a flag.
That might be pass interference.
That looked like it was broken up initially by Jack Dolan, starting a cornerback today for CUA. But a marker down on the play, and we're going to see exactly what the deal is here.
Very good attempt there by Torres to make try get it.
Pass interference, defense number 18. The ball will be placed in the spot, the foul, automatic, down.
It is Jack, pass interference.
Jack Dolan, the guilty boy. It is indeed PI. And Bears are going to get it a lot closer to the end zone. Looks like they're at the 3 or 4 of CUA.
And a first down this close to the end zone. This could spell danger for the Cards when letting up that big play and letting up the first touchdown of the game.
They are indeed at the Cards 3. First and goal to go. Play action, and he's going to throw that one way out of bounds. That was immediate danger. He got run up on in no time by Luke Brautigan, the junior linebacker from Georgia.
Looked like it could almost been a fumble. Excellent pressure there by number 23 for the defense, the Cards. That's Luke Brautigan, I believe that is. Sorry if I butchered that. But that was an excellent play there.
Brautigan with an interception on the year. Cahoon's going to look to pass again, and he's going to hit his man.
It's a touchdown Bears to start this game.
That was a direct shot. Number 86, Ryan Burchard, the tight end from Holliston on the reception. And 6 on the board for Bridgewater State to start this thing out with a minute 15 left in the first.
Off a play action, Burchard just wide open. Not a guy you expected to get the ball there, but gets it and makes the most of it with a touchdown. Excellent play as Nasso is in for the extra point.
Joey Nazo, the freshman from the Empire State, Hopewell Junction, New York. Kick is up, and kick is true without any dispute.
What a play by the Bears. What a drive. Capitalizing on good field position and great opportunity. Nearly disastrous because that pass that was incomplete for Cahoon almost could have been a fumble because of the contact and the way the ball was moving, but it was incomplete. The Bears were able to capitalize and score. Get the first touchdown, the first points of this game.
It took a while, but the Bears are on the board. Turned an interception into 7 points ultimately. They lead the CUA Cardinals 7-0 with a minute 15 to go in the first quarter.
The Cards are going to look to answer here because Casares has had a great season. Hopefully we'll see why. With throwing, he has an interception today, which is unlike him on the season. He has only thrown 4 in the very few games he's played. So we're looking to answer with a touchdown today for this team.
Hanson and Camo, the deep men for the Cardinals. Drake will have the kickoff. 7-0 Bears. And they're looking to come away with a New England Bowl victory on their home turf. And Hansen will allow that one into the end zone for the touchback.
Cardinals ball, first and 10.
If the Bears get a win today, this will be their second win out of second games in the New England Bowl, which is a good percentage to have. Would it be about, 100%? I'm not good at math, but I think that's 100%.
Cardinals are looking for revenge, though. They're a little bitter. They missed out on a chance at the NCAA tournament just last week in a loss to Springfield College. Casares the handoff. And that was Lichardi with the grab.
Nothing to it on that run. Defensive line for the Bears just absolutely smothering that run before it even got a chance to develop. It's an excellent play there.
In the spirit of Thanksgiving, they're going to give Lichardi 2 yards on that carry. Second and 8. Casares wants to air it out this time. He's in danger. Casares running to the sideline, and he is getting dogged. And I do mean dogged by Brian Campagna, who is someone who is very prone to doing that to a quarterback.
Yeah, Campagna made a great play, but my eyes were on Stephen Sylvia the whole time. He was rushing at first, noticed it was a pass, and backed away. And he's back there again trying to make a play on the sideline. An excellent play there by the defense to really have awareness of what's going on.
Campagna and Dan Cataldo, the two starting defensive ends for Bridgewater State, can be tackle machines when they need to be. Quarter about to come to a close. Casares wants to end it on a bang. He tries to work his way out of the pocket. He is threatened and just barely ekes that one out to John Maines for a couple of yards.
I thought this would be a sack. He moves up in the pocket, avoids a tackle there by Cataldo, and finds the receiver for a good few yards.
First quarter's over. Cardinals are trying. Bears are doing. 7-0 Bears after 15 minutes here at Swenson Field in the 2022 New England Bowl.
As the Cards take the field again for the second half, it'll be a fourth and short. And, you know, it's going to be exciting to see what they can do in that scenario. You have to assume they're going to go for it. I don't think we're going to see a lot of punting today, because we haven't so far. We've seen a few fourth downs in the situation. So I'm assuming they're going to go and punt. They're going to do the opposite of punt. They're going to try to go for it. The question is, how are they going to go for it? How are they going to strike, and how are they going to answer the Bears' touchdown?
I know we were talking about this at the top of the broadcast, but I really thought this Cardinals offensive unit would be putting it in the air more often. That's been Casares' calling card. We were talking about some of the stats, the differences between their passing and ground games. They really are a pass play team, the CUA Cardinals, and I'm a little surprised that Casares has been leading a lot more heavily on the handoffs. He's been handing it to Coletti. He's been handing it to Lichardi. He's been handing it to a lot of guys, and the passes have been very conservative so far today.
And I just realized I was incorrect. This is actually, they have punted before. We have called Donovan's name before. Looks like the Cardinals are looking to punt here.
Looks like that's exactly what they're going to do. Connor Gill punting for the Cardinals. Donovan back to grab it for the Bears, and he's not going to get near it. Little extra on the play. We see a bit of a tumble from number 50. The safety, Joey Chupella, went down for some reason. I don't know.
I think he wanted to feel the turf felt, you know. I want to know what the grass felt like.
It feels cold. It's brisk out here today at Swenson Field.
Very chilly today.
Bears are going to take over from their own 20. They've already put 7 on the board. They lead 7-0 with most of the second quarter remaining. Cahoon play action, looking for a pass, gets it. That's going to be a first down and change.
Cahoon's pass complete to number 6. It's Kyle Torres with it. Kyle Torres like I mentioned before this game, was leading receiver, but only had one catch for 16 yards a week ago, and Michael Nocera has taken over as leading receiver. Both these guys are very dynamic.
The senior wide receiver duo, they are both great in the passing game.
Another carry for right there.
Picks up about five.
That's just a powerful run. Like the opening was there. He just sort of gets as many yards as he can out there.
It's very interesting to see Isaiah Wright, who is not a huge guy, adding another yard on top of the linebacker Nazaro, who is 216 pounds, 6 foot wow. one. And Isaiah Wright takes him for a yard or two.
It's a horse of a man there.
Second and five, Wright's going to run with it again, and he's got the first down.
Look at the speed on that guy. Able to run to the edge off of the tackle. Just a nice quick pitch to Wright, and Wright just takes it for a first down with all the speed of his legs. Excellent play there by Wright.
Bears have always shown themselves to be about that next man up mentality. Isaiah Wright is exemplifying that out here today.
Because you're wondering how cold it was. Look at the coats that these cheerleaders are wearing. Very thick coats.
First down and 10 from the Bears' own 44. Cahoon wants a pass play, trying to break his way out of the pocket, and he's going to step up for maybe a yard. He was in great danger there, threatened by the defensive end, Huey Bodger.
It's a very heads-up play by Cahoon. The play breaks down. Even the pocket starts to break down, but he just starts to move forward and try to get it wherever he can, which is a very smart heads-up play. Able to avoid any injury and as much contact as possible.
Huey Bodger's in the hunt for his first sack of the year for the Cardinals. And he came darn close on that play. Second and nine. Cahoon did indeed pick one up. Play action. Wants a pass. Has Torres. Torres trying to break with it. And he gets taken down for a couple extra. That was a bit of a fierce throw by Noah Miller. And it only added a couple more.
I believe with that puts Kyle Torres as the back to leading receiver for this team. He's had an excellent season and didn't do much last week, but he's already done a lot today. He's done more than he had last week.
Looks like the initial stop, I stand corrected, belonged to Webb. No, Sarah picks up that one.
They're just going to be trading off as leading receiver for this team. Nocera was like, that's my title. You can't take it from me.
He gets
more yards.
We were talking about the senior receiver duo. It's Torres and Nocera getting a lot of work done in the sky for the Bears. And suddenly Bridgewater State's offense is moving at a breakneck pace. Handoff gain of a couple.
Greg Dimitri again.
Bears are working with kind of a little bit of a patchwork crew today, not the same crew that they've worked with.
They have a committee of running backs coming in due to very, very meaningful injuries to the running backs last week. But just excellent. They've made the most of their opportunities.
It's such a huge change. Dimitri isn't even on my depth chart, for goodness sake. Second and six. Motion man Nocera. Cahoon in the air, and he's going to throw that right away.
Bit of a miscommunication there, I believe, is want the receiver to run a corner route to the back of the end zone, but no one was going that way, and the ball ends up hitting no man's land.
Cardinals are trying to apply the pressure, but it might be too little too late. At least that's what the Bears are hoping. But the Bears are going to be stuck in third down.
Bears can answer with a two-possession lead in the second half. Third and six
from the 12-yard line. It's worth noting neither of these teams has a particularly great record in third and fourth down conversions. Bears convert at just 42% of the time. That number is the same both in interconference and conference play. Cahoon trying to step out of the pocket again, wants a hit, gets a hit, and just shy of the goal line.
Oh, that's going to be Torres again. Wow, what a powerful grab for our first down. But it was a powerful tackle there by number 29 for the Cardinals. This could be number 29. Can't find his name on my depth chart. Adam Long, sophomore out of Garden City, New York.
First and goal to go for the Bears. They're real close. Another handoff, and that's good for six. Sneaking into the end zone, Greg Dimitri, touchdown.
Greg Dimitri almost untouched into the end zone. Excellent play there. The offensive line, the blocking up front was perfect for him. As here's the play again up close. Greg Dimitri basically untouched, lowers the shoulder and gets in. No one was stopping him. Put a brick wall in front of him, he'd run right through it.
Too little, too late for the CUA line. Nazo back out for the extra point. And that one's true. 10.5 to go in the first half. Bears lead 14-0, and they're playing like it.
Yeah, the Bears, they... some, you know, there's a flag on the field. Some monitoring, but...
We'll see what that is.
The Bears have played a great game so far today, at least. And had a great season.
And if we're lucky, maybe the officials' mic will work this time. We've had some trouble with that. That was an issue a couple of weeks ago.
It's harder to do when it gets a little windy.
Are we sure it's just the wind? Are we really sure?
Who knows?
Well, provisionally, it's 14-0 Bears.
Yeah. Oh, roughing the kicker on the defense, number 18. The penalty will be enforced on the kickoff, 15 yards.
So the guilty party is the defensive back, Jack Dolan, the junior from Connecticut, for the Cardinals. PAT stands, and Bears do indeed lead 14-0.
And you can assume that this ball is going to be kicked straight to the back. And there might even be the Swenson pitch behind the field as how far this ball might be kicked out. But, as you know, we have Shane Drake has the potential to launch this ball.
So play is going to continue, and the Cardinals' penalty will be enforced after kickoff.
Right at the 50-yard line.
Oh, they're going to enforce it on kickoff instead. So Shane Drake is going to be kicking off from midfield. And the Cardinals, well, honestly, at that distance, they're probably going to end up with a touchback. Let's be real here.
Absolutely.
14-0 Bears. They're rolling in their bowl game. And this is just one half of the New England Bowl, mind you. Plymouth State also down here in the Commonwealth, taking on UMass Dartmouth.
It is a touchback. Worth mentioning, the last time the Bears played in the New England Bowl, it was back in 2018. It was a victory against Salve Regina, 34-19. They're probably looking to do the same thing again today.
They're trying to get even further out in front.
Well, the Cards are going to be able to answer to here. It all depends on what the offense can do against this very powerful Bears defensive front.
Maybe this is just my personal conjecture, but it seems like kind of a goofy thing to enforce the penalty at kickoff and just have a touchback and put the Cardinals back at the 25. Anyway, you know, you end up with, hey, I'm just saying.
I don't make the rules.
Neither do I. Casares is going to hand off, and that went nowhere.
It's Brian Campagna with it. An awesome play, sniffing out immediately. Let's watch this again. The handoff and immediately gets taken down, nearly fumbling it.
Coletti thought he had something. Campagna decided he had nothing. Loss of two on the play.
Stopped by number 95, Brian.
Second and 12 for the Cards. Play action. Quick, conservative little dump over to Shields. And he's going to pick up two or three.
Got the yards back they lost from the previous lay and a little bit more. It's a quick handoff, a little jump off of a fake jet sweep.
Owen Shields, the wide receiver from Pennsylvania. Whole lot of Pennsylvanians on this Cards roster.
So about being in Washington, D.C. helps bring in some Pennsylvanians. I'm not sure.
That was Shields' seventh reception of the season. Third and nine. Shields got back three. Casares, pass play, up ahead, off the fingers. The intended destination there was Sam Cornaccione, the tight end from North Carolina. I hope I said that name correctly.
It's a very Italian name.
It's a very Italian name, and I'm a very Portuguese man, and I will leave the pronunciation of Italian names to those who are experts in the field.
It's hard to say Italian names without doing the little hand motion, but you know, we'll keep it clean.
Cards get four and outed. Gill's gonna punt it away. Donovan is back deep again for the Bears. And that's not a terrible punt, to be honest with you. And they're gonna.
Ooh, it could have been a muffed punt there. The Cards get the ball back in the Bears territory.
Cardinal sideline sure is convinced they've got it, and it looks like they were right. Huge defensive play.
It could be. Yeah, the Bears defense staying out there. And that's Cardinals ball again.
So Campagna and Coe are locked back in. Huge recovery there.
It's like they never left.
Cards start over at the Bridgewater 38. First trip handoff for a first down. That was Lichardi.
What a turn of events for the Cardinals there. They get the muff punt and they get a first down right back. That was the first down they've had this drive. They get one the last time they had it, and they get the punt and they get the ball back and they get a first down, their first play.
And that was a huge recovery. Credit where it's due to Malachi Hansen, who recovered that drop and put the Cards in this position.
Coming out of the shotgun.
Kassara is looking to exploit this and finally get some points on the board. Another handoff to Lichardi, and he's going to sneak his way up to move the chains.
Lichardi, another Italian-sounding name, but as he takes the handoff here.
And a Bridgewater player is shaken up on the play.
Oh, man, you do not want to see that. This is a very special game for this team. An injury like that, not what you want to say.
Man down on the field for Bridgewater State.
It's number 40, that's Cody Sautome, who's starting at linebacker.
Sautome usually deeper in the rotation, and he's up and walking off under his own power. The junior from Warren, Rhode Island.
He'll come out for this play, potentially this drive, and the Cardinals will be back on offense. Bears will have to try to find an answer without him.
Cards are going to look to poke further through those holes. Ben McMahon is going to come over and take over for Sautome on the play. First and 10 from the Bears 15. Casares airs it out, got it.
What a pass. That was a beautiful rainbow of a pass. It had the trajectory, had the guy wide open.
Pass complete. 33, big boy shot to Malachi Hansen, and the Cards are on the board.
Hansen, the second leading receiver for this team, and showing why. That was a great answer for the Cards there. They punted it back off the month punt. They got the ball back and they score a touchdown.
Hansen's seventh TD of the year. Extra point is up and good for Fabrizio Riley.
Cahoon is going to come back on the field looking for an answer, but an awesome drive, an awesome play for the Cardinals there.
14-7 Bears, but the Cardinals have shown they're not out of this thing.
There's a reason these teams have winning records. They're both very solid teams, and Cazares is an excellent quarterback, able to put the ball exactly where it needs to be. I could not have thrown that any better. Certainly not.
Oh, don't worry, neither could I. 7:53 to go in the first half. Cardinals on the board. They're going to be kicking off from their left hash. That kickoff's going to belong to the aforementioned Fabrizio Riley. The boot for the Cards from Bethesda, Maryland.
Turner's out back. So Kylan Gilzine-Tucker for the Bears back there. He was listed as the second running back on this depth chart, but seems that Greg Dimitri had different ideas today.
Looks like he's joined out there by Marcus Carpenter. If I'm looking at that number correctly anyhow. His jersey's kind of wrinkled. Wish I had a better look.
It would be Carpenter.
Carpenter it is, but Gilzine-Tucker pulls it out of the air. Working his way up along the side. And he gets absolutely strung up in gory, gruesome detail by Philip Walter.
He made it look good. He catches it. As soon as he starts running, he makes contact. He just tries to run through it. It gets a few yards out of that. Gets about the 19.
Phil Walter swallows him up. Campione helped out. So too did Bodger.
Now the 21, they gave him 21 yards.
Bears looking to answer after they just got scored on. 7:45 to go in the first half. They lead 14-7. First and 10. Cahoon, play action, dumps it off to Nocera. Sneaks his way up the left side, first down.
Yeah, these receivers are the Bears, Nocera and Torres. Like, they are very solid at being able to catch the ball and get separation and be able to run.
Nocera averages 12.2 per catch, 12.2 yards per catch, and he probably got just about that. First and 10 again. Cahoon looking for a pass to the side, gets it to right, just barely keeps it up, trying to put some footwork on the right side.
A solid gain, about 5 or 6 yards. I think about four or three. But Cahoon, through all of his reads, and then he just settles on right, and right takes it for the modest gain there.
It's looking like four and change. Second and five, but it's the lower end of that five.
That's Cahoon. A false start for the Bears.
When have we seen that before today?
Offense number 82.
I couldn't tell you. I don't have enough hands to tell you how many times I've seen that.
That's the wide receiver, Jack McCarthy, who picks that one up. And the Bears are going to get kicked back a couple.
That was a bit of exaggeration. There's only been about four false start calls today. But we like to have fun. This is football. This is fun.
Slightly long, second and 10.
Second and 10 and 33.
Cahoon off to the side, hits Donovan. Trying to step up, can't get a thing. Might have lost a yard.
Cahoon's pass complete to number
we call it no gain, Donovan. I believe. There will be no gain. But Donovan able to catch it, but do nothing with it.
Card's defense is starting to follow up. They're going to say he lost one, actually. Third and 11. Cardinals defense is starting to follow up on the success that the Cardinals offense just showed in the last drive. Third and 11 for Bridgewater State. Play clock trickling down to 10. Six to go in the quarter. Finally, they snap it. Cahoon looking for his outlet. Tries to give it some space, throws an interception. He put that one directly in the hands of Aiden Long. And it's everything that the Bears offense can do to prevent a pick six.
Wow, what a play by Aiden Long. As soon as he gets his hands on it, all he sees is green grass ahead of him, and he just runs. Well, turf, not grass.
Aiden Long coming into this game had one interception on the year. Do you want to know what kind of interception it was?
Pick six.
A 52-yard pick six, and he came darn close to doing something similar right there. Cardinals taking over deep in Bears territory.
The Cardinals needed an answer, and they got their answer. See if they can get a touchdown here. Excellent play by Aiden Long. Wow.
He took that one back for 32 yards, and they're going to be starting over between the Bears 9 and 10.
Ooh. Double pass. They're going to call that pass interference.
It was an initial incompletion. That was an attempted toss by Coletti.
I believe they're going to call that pass interference.
Pass interference. Defense number 13.
That's exactly what they'll do.
Jaron Alves.
Ball's going to be on the Bridgewater 2. First down, Cardinals, and goal to go.
That's just a very unfortunate thing. Jaron Alves is an excellent player for this Bears team. And these penalties can really kill a drive. You know, last time the Bears had their ball in this territory off a penalty, they scored a touchdown. Cards are going to try to do the same thing here. Direct snap, touchdown. Another touchdown for the Cardinals. 14 unanswered points, and the game is tied up. Well, 13. I don't want to get ahead of myself.
It's still not a great look.
This trickeration there is Casares goes out to the right. It's a direct snap to the running back.
That was Coletti for six. And the Cards are closing in. 14-13 Bears before extra point. Fabrizio Riley back out there. Riley connects, and he's now 34 for 35 on PATs.
This game has gotten a lot more interesting.
5.5 to go in the first half. We're all tied up at 14.
The Bears made some mistakes. They got to clean up the game just a little bit. The Cards got to do the same thing, but it has affected both teams too negatively. As the game is now tied up 14-14 in the second quarter with 5.5 minutes to play.
So Donovan and Gilzine Tucker are going to go back out deep for Bridgewater State. Presumably Riley with kickoff from the 35. Yes, indeed. 5:29 to go in the first half. Bridgewater State, who came into this riding high, an absolute knockdown, drag out Cranberry Bowl victory against MMA under their belt from last week. But they're starting to meet their match here today in the form of their fellow 6-4 Catholic University Cardinals, who have put it on the ground a lot more than I thought they would. I just can't get over that. Gilzine Tucker picks it up, rolls off to the left, and he gets tripped up before the Bears 25.
That was a solid run by Gilzine Tucker. You can see he takes it and tries to find an opening. You know, with these kick returns, you get more success when you sort of move around. Just running in a straight line, not really the best idea. You want to sort of move around and cause get your blocks to go develop.
Looked like Carson Henry, the linebacker, got a little bit of disorientation on him there on the play. From Port Jervis, New York, north of the city. Not too far from Pennsylvania.
A bunch formation.
Cahoon hands it off to Wright, ducks his way out of a dangerous situation and picks up a couple more than he was anticipating.
Very solid run by Wright.
Pick up a 5 or 6.
Just kicks it out, runs forward, gets taken down about the 29-yard line.
They're going to say 6. Sure looked like 6. 2nd and 4 from their own 29 are the Bears. Sitting on the right hashes. Cahoon, play action, spaces it out. And a direct hit, but not much more extra yardage to Dan Akinshee.
Akinshee, he's sort of buried on the depth chart, but every time he's on the field, he's making a play. He's an excellent receiver for this team. He's going to be there for a while.
He just picked up reception number 16 on the year. Then tacked on 16 yards.
And Akinshee, the junior out of Pawtucket, Rhode Island.
1st and 10 from the Bears 45. Cahoon, true handoff to Wright, trying to sneak his way up and working really well. He chews up most of the down, probably picks up 8 or 9 on that one.
I think I say he moved, I think they're calling it short, but they look to me like he moved the chains there. Needed to get to about the 45. Gets to, yeah, about the 46-yard line, but excellent play.
He grabs 9 on that one. Wants the extra, doesn't get it. What a takedown right there in the backfield by Jaeger Wesley.
This Cardinals defense is very give and take. They'll give and then they'll take. How it works, usually, yeah.
32 from the 47-yard line. Jaeger Wesley from Newark, and they say it that way, Newark, Delaware. Not to be confused with Newark, New Jersey. Newark, Delaware is in the house. 3rd and 2.
Another bunch formation. top of the bottom of your screen.
He'll hand it off to Wright again, and this time he'll successfully poke through to move the change. Move the chains. He'll change the down and move the chains.
Absolutely. Right, that's just an excellent run. He gets the hole, he gets down. He gets enough for the first down. Good play.
Just over three to go in the first half. We're tied up at 14, but the Bears are slowly but surely making progress. They've poked their way into Cards territory. Specifically, the 42.
And their handoff. It was a big run.
Who else but Wright, and he's going to move it well. Finally, chased out of bounds, first down and then some. Finally escorted out of the house by Michael Hopkins.
I mean, Wright is making plays. He's been making plays all day. He's continuing to do so as he gets this massive run on the sideline up to the 22-yard line.
Last week, Isaiah Wright was a kick returner. Today, he's the hottest running back on the field.
Making great plays. Proven why he's reliable. Will be reliable for a while for this Bears team.
2:24 to go in the first half, 14 all. Bears closing in. They're on the 23-yard line of the Cardinals.
Just taken down is Greg Dimitri.
That didn't work as well as the Bears had hoped.
34 Dimitri on the carry. No gain on the
carry. Right there in coverage, looked like it was Jaeger yet again. Jaeger Wesley with a couple of big stops. That time, no gain. Under two to play in the quarter. Second and 10 coming up for the Bears. Cahoon looking for a less big shot than he thought. Hits Wright. Wright trying to sneak up. He does. Taken outside right around the 4-yard line. Stopped by Nazaro.
How about this? Making the most out of anything. You give him an inch, he takes a yard. He takes it yard almost. He takes it out to about the 3-yard line or 2-yard line potentially. Awesome play there by Wright.
Joe Nazaro with the coverage finally got him out before he turned that into six. But Bears have first and goal to go on the Cardinals 4, and they could retake the lead. They would love to. A minute and a half to play in the quarter.
False start. I was going to say we could see another touchdown from Greg Dimitri, but this false start would make it a little bit harder.
False start. 5 offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
So it's going to be on the 9 now for the Bears. Still not far away. Less proximity than they would have liked.
Where they're going to call that number 5, Michael Nocera.
First and goal to go from the CUA 9. Motion man was Torres. Cahoon looking for Torres. Got him!
It's a touchdown, Kyle Torres!
6 more on the board, courtesy of the senior receiver. And Bridgewater State retakes the lead with just under a minute and a half to go in the first half.
It's 6 for number 6. Excellent play there. Goes out in motion, and there's no one covering him. Number 12 tries to catch up, but is unable to. Torres just catches it and goes down. Excellent.
That was
excellent catch.
That was attempted coverage by the safety, Mason Stillwell, who moved over from cornerback for the day, but Torres just outran him. Nazo out for the extra point for the Bears. It's up, it's true. Bridgewater State back up by 7 with a minute 23 to go in the first half.
That is how you answer. The Bears did a great job of marching down the field and doing exactly what they needed to do. Short, quick passes, getting the ball to their playmaker, Isaiah Wright, who's had an awesome game so far today, proving why he's going to be reliable for the future of this program.
Couple of big plays. Helped in no small part by Isaiah Wright. And Bridgewater State retakes the advantage. It's really interesting to see how the Bears have been able to adapt so far today on the offensive end without Adam Couch, without William Poynter. They're two big ground game guys. I just can't get over how much work Isaiah Wright has been putting in on the running game.
You know, it almost puts the question, how good of a player, of those players, how good are they? If, you know, guys like Isaiah Wright could do it, is it the system? Is it the coaching? Or is it just that the Bears know how to recruit these great running backs?
Isaiah Wright, coming into this game, had 31 rushes the entire year. 31 rushes the entire year. The lion's share of the rushes belonged to Adam Couch. Pointer was next up after him. And it's just really wild. He averaged 23.4 rushing yards a game. A game. Not per play, per game.
The kick is short. It is recovered about the 30-yard line. For the Cardinals.
Sitting on the play there was William.
I'm sure it was.
Was it a 36 or an 86?
Can't remember. I believe it might have been.
Am I just blind today?
It's far away. It's okay. It's hard to tell.
It's not that far away. I just need new glasses. At any rate, Cards are going to be starting from their own 27. Casares looking to pass and just barely squeezes that one out to Derek Akins.
Akins, he is also part of the new MAC first team all-conference team.
Catholic University put a program record 12 guys on the first and second all new MAC teams. Casares trying to run his way out of danger, looking for an outlet, and he throws that one just short.
This ball gets thrown into the ground.
It was intended for Akin, but hit the deck right before it got to him. And you see here the pressure. Who else? Brian Campagna.
Campagna is excellent at generating pressure. Casares has been great to just get the ball out of harm's way. Don't take the sack. Just get rid of it. An incompletion is better than a sack for the most part.
Third down. Casares looking for a play, dumps it back off.
Maybe short of the first down, but they're going to give it to him anyways.
Licciardi picked that one up and moved the chains.
Oh, they're saying he's short instead. It's third and very, very short, but then they're gonna measure it.
Huge play, takedown there by Brendan Albert to potentially not move the chains. CUA is going to take their first time out of the half.
Do you wonder why the NCAA Division III logo includes...
Well, this has been interesting, to say the least.
Absolutely. This has been a very exciting game. It's high scoring for this first half so far. And I think it's going to continue that way as the Cardinals are able to march down the field and respond. They have 34 seconds to do it in the first half before they have to give the ball back to the Bears.
And it's been a couple of teams doing things that they're not used to doing. Catholic University, which usually puts these things in the air on a whole lot of plays, picks up a whole ton more air yards than they do running yards, has been really diversifying its game and sticking to the ground a lot more than certainly I think you or I imagined. Bridgewater State, meanwhile, having to adapt without their two top running backs, and they've certainly done that as well. So both of these teams have really shown themselves to be quite versatile so far this afternoon.
Absolutely, and it certainly helps replacing players like Adam Couch and William Pointer when you have a player like Isaiah Wright who can do it all. He can catch, he can run, he's got a lot of speed to him.
Fourth and one, Cards are going to try their luck. Casares wants to run it in himself, and it sure looks like he did.
He gets the first and he goes down.
30 seconds to play in the opening half. And CUA will take their second timeout after moving the chains.
They're definitely looking to answer here with a touchdown. They have quite a bit of the field to go, but it's definitely possible. I've seen Stranger Things happen. I've also seen the show Stranger Things. Pretty good if you haven't seen it. But you know, there's a lot of things that, you know, we mentioned earlier, the player with Aiden Long with a 52-yard pick six of the game prior. So anything can happen in this part of the field at any point in the game.
And one thing I want to point out certainly is that Casares, certainly through the stats he's put up so far this season, but even here today, is showing how well-rounded he can be. in terms of both managing a ground game, putting it in the air. His stats speak for themselves. The man even has a rushing touchdown on the year for a team that doesn't rush a lot, and a flag on the play. Or, well, play is a strong word. We didn't even get to the play just yet.
False start.
That's a false start on the
UA. 64 offense, 5-yard penalty. It's down.
It's a pre-snap penalty.
The naughty boy is the lineman, Oliver.
Again, a first-team all-NUMAC conference player. You got what I was trying to say. I get the idea. Get the idea.
First team all new Mac, but he just cost CUA 5 yards. First and 15. Half a minute to go in the opening half. Casares wants a pass, and he wants one bad. He's in danger, trying to run away from Campagna, getting run up from behind by Campagna, and he just scampers out of bounds after picking up a few yards.
A great sense of pressure there by Casares. He's rolling out of the pocket, has a decent amount of speed for a quarterback, and just runs to the out of bounds to save that timeout.
He's playing Tom and Jerry with Campagna there, and he's finally escorted up by Sao Tome, who's back on the field for Bridgewater State. 21 to go in the opening half. Second and 8 for the Cardinals. Sao Tome looking for another pass play. Gets more space to make one this time and hits his mark. That was a direct shot to Akins for a whole lot.
And Akins gets out of bounds, and they can save that timeout. But look at this play. It's awesome. He gets the ball, finds a wide open receiver, and Akins just sort of forces him his way out of bounds.
That's and some great excellent. Blocking as well by the CUA offensive line. Cataldo wanted a piece of flesh from Casares. And that Cardinals O-line would not let him get anywhere near.
Bridgewater calling a timeout here. Now, defense can call timeouts, too. Everyone always thinks the only offense can call timeout. The defense can call timeout. Yeah,
this isn't basketball.
It's very good. You know, it's a lot of coaches struggle with clock management. But the defense, they're people, too. They're getting tired. You got to let them get a breather, get some water. It could be a big difference maker in a football game when the defense calls the timeouts at crucial times.
12 seconds to go in the opening half. Bears lead 21-14, but the Cardinals are pressing the issue on the offensive end. They've worked their way into Bridgewater State territory. What do you think the odds are on this next play here with just 12 seconds left in the first half that Casares goes for a big one, a long shot? And how prepared do you think the Bears defense is to prevent against that, whether it's breaking up a pass or even taking down Casares early?
We've seen Casares take plays earlier. It resulted in an interception. But I think it's possible. Casares has some big play potential in him.
First and 10 from the Bridgewater State 33. Casares, there's that long bomb, wants his man off the hands.
Like I said, he's got big play potential. And that's his reliable receiver, Malachi Hansen.
He had so much momentum, he kept going, dropped what would have been a huge 6 points.
He almost found his way into the Bears locker room there.
7 seconds to go in half number one.
I think the Bears are prepared for these big plays now. You want to take a big shot per game. In this situation, you have to take big shots. Potentially go out of bounds. If you go out of bounds, you have a timeout. But
Casares plays it more conservative, dumps it off. That's a gain of a few for Owen Shields.
1 second remaining on the clock here. This has to be an end zone shot, unless they want to take the three off the field goal. But that is very lucky he's able to get down at that time there. There's another timeout for the Cards.
I couldn't hear a darn thing, but it sure sounds like Cardinals are going to take their third and final of the opening half. 1 second left. The intrigue is thick.
This has been a very exciting game. I can guarantee that much. You enjoyed this at home.
I remember, if you were here with us folks from last week's Cranberry Bowl, which was a good game, but it was tough. It was tough. The scoring was so difficult to come by, going both ways. These defenses beat the heck out of each other. And not the same today.
In that game, Cahoon throws 3 interceptions, which is unlike him.
Riley's going to attempt the field goal. No good.
No good. I think it had the distance and the power, but it was not accurate enough. That's the end of the first half of play. The Bears leading 21-14.
Riley unable to connect. He's pretty competent, but that one just a little bit too tough. And the Bears are going to take a 7-point lead into the locker room at halftime. Bridgewater State 21, Catholic University of America, their sparring partners for the first time in program history, 14. 30 minutes of football gone. We'll be right back with you after halftime here on the Bears Sports Network on BTV for the 2022 New England Bowl.
Opportunities for me as an undergraduate here at BSU are essentially limitless. I've gotten an internship, I've been going to these great classes. I've definitely been given the ability to pursue something that's so passionate and dear to me.
Well, half a football game is over, but how eventful has it been? As we start the third quarter here at Swenson Field on the campus of Bridgewater State University, Bridgewater State University Bears lead the Catholic University of America Cardinals 21-14 in the 2022 New England Bowl and the first ever meeting between these two programs.
Absolutely, and so far it's been pretty good. 21-14, Bears lead. But, you know, it's been a war of attrition. Both teams have been moving down the field. They've committed some costly penalties, but they've also turned the ball over a few times.
We talked pregame about how the Cardinals are often putting it in the air, but Bridgewater State by far leading the passing game yardage-wise through the first half. They've converted first down more often than the Cardinals by 2-1, but they've turned it over more as well. Calhoun has found himself sacked three times. Casares for the Cardinals has been taken down twice. Both teams have played very well, but both have spots they want to tighten up as we prepare to embark on half number two.
You'll see the two turnovers and three turnovers. If you want to win the game, you got to clean that up. You can't afford to have too many turnovers as a team. That'll definitely give the other team the win as you're literally giving them the ball back.
Gill to kick off for the Cardinals. Bears will start the second half off on offense. It's Kion Gill, Zine Tucker. Out back deep.
Along with Carpenter.
And Carpenter. As we were talking about, took me a second to figure it out because usually it's right back there, but Isaiah Wright has been too busy leading all running backs in the ground game in yardage. He picked up 88 net yards on the floor in the first half. To say nothing of 30 yards in the air, he has been on fire today, even though Bridgewater State is missing their two starting running backs in Couch and Pointer.
Absolutely. You know, the Bears have been able to do what they've been doing all season, which is running the ball very well. And they've been doing it on the back of a guy who's getting pretty much his first reps as a starter in his college career. So
adaptation really the key word for Bridgewater's day-to-day, but as well for the Catholic University season. Casares, as we mentioned in the first half, took over at the starting job after an injury, sat down their original starting QB, Madden Lowe. But Casares has proven himself to be perfectly fine handling the job. Gilzine Tucker stepped out of bounds with it, it looked like. There's a flag on the play. It either went out or he stepped out with it. One of the two sure looked like it bounced out a little bit.
The penalty might have been the kickoff went out of bounds. The Bears might get the ball in good position.
That's true. You're right. We'll see in a moment.
When he recovered the ball on the kicking team.
Out of bounds. So they're calling
down.
I believe they're calling that kickoff out of bounds.
But with the officials' mic issues, I picked up approximately 11% of what he just said right there. The final call is that he picked it up out of bounds. You see right here. Tooling around over there. He picked it up. Ball itself was in bounds, but his foot was on the line.
And the referee remembers, oh, that's a penalty. they throw the flag after the fact.
I'll be honest, we've seen some good officiating here today, you know.
Everyone messes up sometimes. It's all right.
Pobody's Nerfic, they say. Bears are going to start out from their own 35. First and 10, they lead 21-14 with 30 minutes of football still yet to be played. Calhoun and company back out there. He's going to start out. Guess what? Hand off to Isaiah Wright. And he's going to pick up maybe a yard.
Right, you got to give credit to like the defensive line there preventing that big play. It was very often these plays are broken up by the tackles. He was forced into a hole he couldn't make anything out of. So great play by the defense there.
Second and 9 from the 36. Right in motion. Cahoon looking for a pass. Looking for Wright. Gets him off to the side, but he's not picking anything up just yet. And he folds behind the line of scrimmage.
Screen passes are very risky because they have the potential to be very good if the protection is good. But if the defense isn't blitzing, it's not a great time to call a screen pass. We see right there the defense is ready for that.
And tough coverage there by the linebacker, Michael Hopkins from Ohio. Third and 12. Cahoon looking for something bigger this time. Trying to really space it out. Incomplete. That one was intended for Nocera, but off his fingertips.
Nocera put his hand up. He's like, I want that ball. Cahoon was like, all right, if you say so, and tried throwing it right to him and broke it up on the sideline.
Bears are going to go 4 and out to start out the second half.
Shane Drake in to punt the ball away. This is his first punt of the day.
And you get a beautiful view of our track here and a Cub Cadet. Shane Drake's first punt of the day. Malachi Hansen out deep for the Cardinals.
Hansen, the dangerous returner for this Cardinals team.
And boy, has he been a little bit of a show today. Hansen grabs it at the 35, starts rolling his way up, trying to work on the right side. He's going to break for a good few and take that thing to midfield. Wowza.
It's a great vision there to try to get around to the right, to his right, around the blockers. He gets past quite a bit of them.
His average punt return is 17.2 yards. He can get crafty when he needs to.
He's absolutely a threat.
Took that one for just about 20.
He's a threat when he has the ball, so try to prevent him from getting that ball for the Bears.
First and 10 from the Cardinals in Bears territory. First time around, Casares is going to opt to hand off to Lichardi. Lichardi's been a stalwart on the ground game today for CUA. Pick up a 5 on the play, second and 5 coming up.
Out of the shotgun.
Second and 5, Casares wants a pass, airing it out. Big one, and just incomplete. That one slipped through the hands of Akins.
I believe that's Akins' second drop on a big play like that. You cannot afford to not catch these balls if you're the Cardinals. You got to score. You got a lucky, well, maybe not lucky, but you got a great defensive stop. You got to try to score, tie this game back up.
Third and 5 for CUA. Casares looking to reset. Handoff. That one again to Lichardi. He's going to break through for first down yardage.
When you're able to establish the ground game, the whole offense just starts to work. It starts clicking. You need to be able to get easy first yards, easy yardage with the run game, and then the pass will open. That's just how football works.
Lichardi calls East Greenwich, Rhode Island home, one of the nearer members of this CUA roster. Play action. Quick dump off and some fancy footwork, and pushing away his head is Sam Cornaccione.
Cornaccione on the tight end screen, runs a flat route, gets met, but he's able to avoid some tackles.
Looks like he's finally bowled over by Souza there, but it was too little too late. Flag on that play. That looked like a mess. Couple different flags.
It was a carry by Lichardi.
Actually, I think the first official who threw his marker actually picked it back up and threw it further.
It's an acceptable 10-yard penalty, second down.
It'll be a holding call. Couldn't really get a shot of that off after the replay, but it was a run by Lichardi, and it was holding. It brings it back.
Have you ever seen an official pick up the marker they just threw and then throw it a little bit further?
I'm not really sure if I have.
Because they announced that the guilty party was number 71, Daniel McGowan. Oh, no, I stand corrected. Caramanico. They double up their numbers here. So 71 on offense for the Cardinals is James Caramanico, the sophomore from Raleigh. Another handoff to Licciardi. He's going to try to break through. Puts the spin move on a couple of times and chews up most of the down.
Licciardi there kind of looking like my washing machine just kept spinning and spinning and trying to break all these tackles and see it again. Gets the opening and then spins again. And he's met by Steven Sylvia and company.
And Souza falls on them like a comfy mattress after a day of hard work. And it's third and one for the Cardinals. Would love to tie this one up.
And we're five wide.
In the air, Casares looking for, got him. Direct shot to Preston Jeffrey. Touchdown, CUA.
Awesome play there by Preston Jeffrey, the leading receiver for this team. That's his eighth touchdown of the year, I believe. Unless he had one earlier in the day, which I don't believe so. But that was an excellent replay there.
Preston Jeffrey, the DMV man, comes up from his native Virginia and puts six on the board. And the extra point is true. From Fabrizio Riley. I'm telling you, it's these Italian names. We're all tied up again, 11-11 to go. And CUA made a wish, and they got it. 21 all here at Swenson Field in the third quarter.
What a way to answer. That was a big shot, too, into the end zone. The Cardinals, they have big play potential, and they're showing it there. Every play, every time Caseros has a ball, I've got his name for a second. Every time Cazares has the ball, he's able to make plays with it.
Usual suspects for kickoff. Riley doing the deed. Gilzine Tucker and Carpenter out deep for Bridgewater State.
This has been one of the more exciting games that we've seen in a long time. Both teams with big high scoring potential. This is a very important game for both teams.
It's a very even match. They both came in 6-4. Each of them looking for a bowl game victory. Gilzine Tucker grabs the kick and sneaks his way up to about the 23 or 24.
Every good kick return comes with good blocking. And that's the key point right there. And he gets back to where he could have gotten it. He's got a pass.
Nice block by Carpenter there, really.
He gets a pass where he could have gotten it if he just called a fair catch, but he decided to take it and gets better field position.
Bears have an issue to press after all. They're tied up 21 each with Catholic University. 11 minutes to play here in the third quarter.
It's worth noting linebacker Cody Saitomi being wrapped up in the sideline. Hopefully be able to come back into this game.
Took a bit of an injury in the first half, but then came back for a couple plays. Cahoon nearly dropped it, and he's going to have to run with it himself and pick up maybe a yard. That was a near fumble for James Cahoon, but he's just able to grip on for dear life.
I mean, that was a very heads-up play. It was a snap or him getting his hands on it, but ball started coming out. He decided not to hand it off and just take it himself.
They're going to give him a yard. He keeps it on the plus side. 2nd and 9 Bears. Cahoon looking for a pass this time with a much firmer grip. Trying to air it out off the fingertips of McCarthy.
That was
pretty skillful coverage there, if I may say so myself, by Luke Broutigan.
I mean, that was just great coverage there. Both players went up for the ball, and it was just unlucky.
Or I stand corrected. Broutigan took the credit, but in reality, that coverage belongs to Mason Stillwell, the defensive back from Annapolis, Maryland.
McCarthy having a great season, unable to do anything on that play.
But Broutigan sure knew when to show up. 3rd and 9, Cahoon trying to run it with his lonely self again, and he barely gets anything.
Interesting choice for Cahoon to run it, and maybe the pressure got to him a little bit, but not really. He had time.
It's going to be interesting enough to engage Shane Drake as the kicking unit comes out to punt it away for the Bears.
I mean, possibly he probably could have gotten more time with a potential like pump fake, find a receiver open, but he decides to take it off, and that's his decision. This is what he made. And now it's a punt for the Bears.
The aforementioned slippery eel Malachi Henson, who can put in some pretty solid punt returns when he wants to out deep for the Cardinals, but that wasn't the best punt in the world. It's going to roll underneath Hansen's feet, and Bears are going to sit it down at about the Cardinals' 39-yard line.
That was about probably the best they could have gotten out of that punt with a roll like that. A few bounces, very good bounces for the Bears there.
Cards are going to start on their own 39. 9:37 to go in the third quarter here at Bridgewater State University. 21 all. There's been a lot of intrigue today, no doubt about that.
The Cards have the chance to get their first lead of the game.
Casares the handoff to Licciardi, and he pokes his way up for 3 or 4.
He's the run again with Licciardi going down.
This is total speculation, but Licciardi being a relatively local guy, he certainly doesn't see any shortage of time in the run game for CUA, but you start to wonder if they're sort of giving him a chance to shine in what's essentially his home territory.
I mean, possibly. You know, I think he's definitely one of the best rushers they have on this team coming into this season, or coming into this game. So
he picked up 1 yard on that one.
You got to let your players play. And that's what they're doing with Licciardi today. Licciardi, second in the team coming into this game in rushing behind Jared Coletti.
3rd and 4. Cards would love another bombastic play. Sautomi with Camo right next to him. Hands it off to Camo, and he breaks his way up for first down yardage. Andrew Camo, the running back from Brookville, Maryland, sees what I believe is his first touch of the afternoon.
The flip looked like a superhero there, just getting a flip over the
defense. Just his first or second.
Awesome play there. It's enough for a first down.
1st and 10 from the Bridgewater State 47, and the Cards are pressing the issue yet again. Camo one more time. Just barely squeezes his way up for, looked like three.
Giving the ball to Camo was successful the first time. Why not try a second time as he gets it? It gets about a few, possibly 4 yards.
He squeezes out 3 yards like toothpaste out of the tube. And it's going to be 2nd and 7 for the Cards from the BSU 44. 7.5 to play here in the third quarter. Casares hands it off to Camo again. And he got maybe one. They're keeping it on the floor a ton more than I think any scouting report would have told.
Yeah, I mean, they want to get the run game developed. They've been running it better than the Bears have been, at least as the numbers show. But you know, having a solid ground game will help the game progress further. It'll help you get towards the end of the game quicker. It'll also develop the pass as the defense tries to cover the run.
3rd and 6. Motion man Paul. Intended target, Giordano. And it worked, but it's not going to move the chains.
The motion man with a great block there. He knew the ball wasn't going to him, so he just decided, I'm going to take Darren Alves out of the play, and he does so.
And a big target there as well, or a big takedown, I should say, by Albert. Prevents that first down yardage. And the Cards are going to be stuck in 4 and 3.
You can imagine this is going to be a pass out of play action. A timeout. Recalled.
Bears want to talk things over. They're going to take the first timeout of the half by either team.
This is the most crucial down of the game so far. It's 4th and 3 in your own territory. I think it's a great call to call a timeout here. Make sure everything's correct. Make sure you want to call the right play. See what they're coming out and see what you can do to you could do to stop them from converting this fourth down.
I would be inclined to think, based on what we've seen from the Cardinals today, you know, we thought they would focus more on the air game, but they've been kind of spreading it out a lot more than I think certainly I expected. It's kind of an ambiguous distance that they've got facing them. They only need to squeeze out 3 yards to keep this drive alive. Do you think they go in the air or on the ground? Because both have been working for them to a pretty considerable degree so far today.
I think they might mix it up a bit, but go with a play action pass for a short yardage.
Fourth and three. Well, they'll pass all right. Kassara's in the air, incomplete.
That's an unfortunate throw there, a bit too low for the receiver. But, you know, I think there was a pseudo play action pass there, and then they could have probably got the defense to bite a bit if they had a play action there. But
intended target Shields can't get his fingers on it, and the Cardinals turn it over on downs.
You know, I think the ball just needed to be thrown a bit higher. It was in a great spot for not to get for the defender to make a play on it, but the receiver also couldn't make a play on it either.
Bears pick up from their own 40. Cahoon play action. Scoops that one across. And Carpenter chews up most of the down. Marcus Carpenter, the freshman from Hope, Rhode Island. We talked earlier about these young guys really getting a lot of touches for Bridgewater State, particularly on the offensive end, and Carpenter right here, no exception.
Absolutely. You know, this team has a lot of seniors on it, a lot of players who might not be here next year, so you get enough production from these young players. And there's a flag on the field, but for the time being, that play is for a first down.
Carpenter again was in the mix. Put a marker down back at the BSU 39.
Illegal shift on the offense.
Legal on the offense. Two men in motion at the snap. 5 yard penalty, second down.
I think what happens here potentially, I think as the player was in motion, Cahoot also moves a bit, which causes the flag.
Second and six from the Bears' own 44. Cahoon looking for the air again. Hits Nocera, but he's not getting much space at all.
Let's take it down to be Torres.
I stand corrected. That was Torres. Number five, number six. We were just having this chat earlier last half about my prescription glasses. Both Torres and Nocera get a lot of receptions. That time it was Torres, but no gain on the play.
The screen passes are very good. I like a good screen pass myself, but you gotta be able to call them at the right time. That was not one of those times.
5 minutes to play in the third quarter, tied up at 21.
Cut on Gilsey and Tucker out wide.
Cahoon looking for a pass. He's gonna leave that one with Kopecky, and he'll scamper across for first down yardage.
Chili Kopecky, not getting involved very much in this game, but we've called his name at least a handful of times before. And he's getting a big first down for the Bears.
Kopecky's the kind of guy, he pops up when you least expect him in a play. He can make some very important catches.
He can even run the ball too when they need him to in the Wildcat. We've seen that before.
First and 10 at Bridgewater, correction, the Cardinals 45. That toss over to Nocera, and it really is Nocera this time.
Yeah, Nocera.
And he'll be possibly the one moving the chains. We'll see. That was a very close one.
They're calling it short, but I mean, great movement there. The shift of his legs. He jukes out, tries to get an extra few yards, and gets out of bounds.
He chewed up a lot. Second and three for the Bears from the Cards 38. Kopecky was in motion there. Cahoon hands off to Wright, and he pokes his way through the hole for the first down.
Wright continues to have a great game today. You see him again with a first down, an excellent run. Just sort of, it looks like he gets caught up, but he pops out the other end.
He's starting to embrace this role at running back, Isaiah Wright is. They've got at least two more years with this fella, and I imagine he could be getting a taste of His responsibilities come next year or the year after. Cahoon looking for a pass, but has to slip his way out of the pocket. Now he's going to try to air it out to the end zone. Kopecky for six.
Jalen Kopecky was uncovered in the end zone.
What are we talking about? You know what I mean? We were just saying this. Every now and then, it will be one explosive play where Jalen Kopecky slips out of the woodwork and puts his name on the board, and he does it again right here. Bears lead at 27-21.
Jalen Kopecky, as naked as he was on his birthday, Kopecky wide open in the end zone for a touchdown. Excellent play for Kopecky.
Slicker than oil, extra point coming up from Joey Nazo.
The kick is good for Nazo.
Bears lead it by seven again. Jalen Kopecky grabs his fifth touchdown of the season, and it comes at a clutch time. 3:27 to go in the third quarter. Bears 28, Cardinals 21. Wow, what a play.
This is certainly one of the most exciting games we've had this year.
Especially interesting considering the pressure in the pocket that Cahoon was facing just moments before. He's able to sneak his way out, find just enough space to get one off to Kopecky, who of course is alone. I think they just sort of expected maybe that Cahoon was going to fold before exterior defense needed to do anything.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, Cahoon doesn't get to show off his mobility very often, but there he was moving around the pocket, creating opening. Looked like he was about to throw it, about to run it. The defense moves back a bit, finds the opening, and gets it to Kopecky for an excellent play there. Awesome play by the Bears.
Drake kicking off for the Bears. Hansen and Camo deep for the Cardinals. 28-21 Bridgewater. First time these two teams have ever met. Hansen's going to scoop it and windmill his way through and go down right around the 35 or 36.
I mean, with a score like this, you know, We might be seeing a rivalry game developing.
This is competitive. This is really competitive, especially considering that for football, at least, CUA is in the new MAC. They spend a whole lot of time at this end of 95. It's possible they'll meet again. Doesn't happen often. Certainly hasn't happened until now, but a very hotly contested game. I think this is the kind of fight both of these teams have wanted all year.
This is very awesome. If both these teams be eligible for bowl games in the future, who knows what will happen.
Long held play action, just gets that one off awkwardly, and it does not land in the hands of Preston Jeffrey.
That's not very characteristic of Jeffrey, but he does a great job pretending like he's run blocking.
Yeah,
that was
a feature film length play action hold.
He pretended he was blocking for the run and then finds a seam, just unable to haul it in.
Jeffrey, who's already got a TD on the afternoon, couldn't haul in a wobbler there, and it's 2nd and 10.
Looking for instructions. Receiver in motion.
Motion man Akins. This time it really is a handoff to Lichardi, and he can't get a darn thing.
Just absolutely swallowed up. Almost as soon as he gets it, gets maybe half a yard out of that, but we'll give him about one.
He gets a whole lot of work from the D lineman, Lewis Casey.
Lewis Casey has had a great season so far. He's not playing a lot of snaps today, but he's made a statement so far this year.
They're going to give him 2 yards on the carry. That's what Lichardi will get. 3rd and 8 from the 38. Say that 5 times fast. Casares looking for a big pass play this time. Oh, he airs that thing out, trying to find out of the hands of Hansen. That would have been Sports Center top 10 if he hauled it in, but he's just not able to get a grip.
I swear, I almost screamed that was a catch. That was awesome play. You got the defender on the ground. Let's watch this again. He gets the defender on the ground, just goes up and tries to get it, but unable to. That would have been awesome.
That's some creative coverage by Alves there.
We would have seen that on TV. Randy Moss would have been saying, come on, man, somebody. Sitting on SportsCenter.
Sometimes I wish they had shacked in a fool for football. That wouldn't really qualify. That was a hard-fought one. CUA will punt it away. There goes Gill. Donovan is just going to let it sit. And the Bears will take over around the 20 or 21.
Wow, this game has been awesome to watch. That play wasn't successful, but it was really cool to see. These defenders have the ability to make plays.
I've had a big old goofy smile on my face the whole half. This has been really, really hard-fought football. But certainly at no expense of excitement or intrigue. Bears lead at 28-21.
The sides of my mouth hurt from how much I've been smiling, dude. This has been awesome.
That's a good problem to have. Bears are going to start on their own 21. First things first, handoff for a couple.
A couple yards here, a couple yards there. They're good to set up drives. It won't win you the touchdown potentially, but getting 2 yards here and there is pretty good to start a drive.
I find it funny that Wright is able to plow into and sit down Liul Mungugeta, the senior from Alexandria, who weighs 263 pounds.
Wow.
That's not a typo. And Isaiah Wright just sat him down. Cahoon's going to look for a play on 2nd and 7, looking for a pass initially. Then he's just going to run it himself. He's going to get more than he really thought he would, and he stumbles his way into first down yardage. He didn't even mean to do that.
There's mobility on this quarterback. You never get to see it on tape, but here it is.
He literally falls his way into first down yardage.
They call that falling forward, don't they?
Like a small child trying to run down the slide on the playground, James Cahoon picks up a fresh set of downs. Bears at their own 34, a minute to play in the third quarter. They lead it by 7. Motion man Kopecky. Another handoff to Wright. He'll sneak up for 2 or 3.
Man, this game has been awesome to watch. This big play after big play. This one, not quite as big, but still exciting. Good tackle there. But man, my cheeks hurt, man. This I'm smiling all day.
2nd and 7 from the 37. Less than a minute to play in the third quarter. Bears looking to carry some positive momentum into the 4th and final. Motion man Carpenter. Cahoon has to fall on it.
He fell over. He looks like he got tripped potentially there.
And I still think he might have picked up a yard.
Yeah, it looked like he tripped over his offensive lineman unwanting to, but tried to adjust, couldn't, and falls over.
It be your own people sometimes, and he lost 2 on that play. And the third quarter is going to come to a close, or will it?
It will.
No, it will. I saw the clock freeze for a second. I thought somebody might have called timeout. Nope. 45 minutes of football are in the books. And they've been real smilers. Bears 28, Cardinals 21. They're meeting for the first time. Who knows if they'll ever meet again, but Bridgewater State wants to leave an impression.
Man, I mean, this is something that both teams are going to look back on and be like, man, what a game. We played well. We had highs, we had lows. Both teams have given an edge and taken a yard.
And I can tell you, whoever comes away with the win here today, and it really could be either one of these teams, up here in the press box, there's some pretty slick-looking hardware. A trophy for the team that pulls this win away, and a plate, big old silver plate, for the MVP of the game. So whoever comes away with the dub here this afternoon is in for some fresh looks in a cup-shaped mirror later today.
I mean, it might be too early to call, but I think for either team, at least especially for the Bears, with the top of MVP, I think Isaiah Wright, you got to put his name in there. Either him or Cahoon are going to be the top players, but Wright has shown out tonight despite, you know, low expectations of runs.
Mm-hmm. But Wright's been stepping up, but certainly the Cardinals have been putting in no dearth of offensive effort. They've really been pushing the issue as well. They're only down by 7 as we start the fourth quarter. They've really been running this offense by committee, running things a lot through Lichardi, but when it gets to the air game, they're spreading it out a lot, and it works really well for CUA.
For Catlin, you got to assume the MVP, if they do end up winning, would have to be Cazares. He's going to have to lead this team down the field.
Bears will start the fourth quarter at 3rd and 9 from their own 35. Motion man Donovan. Cahoon looking for a pass. Spaces one out, Kopecky, and he's gonna break it across midfield.
This guy, man, Kopecky. What a beautiful, he found a soft spot in coverage, goes right in there. Cahoon puts it right where it needs to be. And Kopecky, with glue on his hands, catches it.
Just when you think they've learned to watch Jalen Kopecky, they haven't.
Kopecky is a threat. He can run the ball too out of the Wildcat. We've seen him do it.
Bears pick up 33. And they'll get a fresh set of downs at CUA's 32. Motion man Torres. Play action. There goes McCarthy.
McCarthy, 6'4", 210 out of Braintree. He's got a big body. He just sort of uses all of it there to just get the technically gets taken down, but excellent play.
Took him a second, but they've just now decided that Mr. McCarthy's going to first downville. 14 minutes to play in regulation at the Cardinals, 21. Hand off to right. And he's going to grab maybe two or three.
Some great trick creation. I thought Nocera had the ball, but it goes right to Isaiah Wright. And it's
been doing that a lot today.
he's made the most out of it as well. I would not complain if I was Coach Joe Varia for the Bears. He's played well.
He's been moving and grooving. Christian Torres is going to come in on the line for the Bears and replace Lookman Belogan. 2nd and 7 from the 18. Play action. Cahoon spacing it out. Wants another shot.
Falling over is Jack McCarthy. They're not going to call that a pass interference. He sort of tripped over and fell.
Looked like some coverage. Courtesy of Aiden Long, the defensive back.
And then maybe Jack McCarthy has maybe an argument for pass interference, but he doesn't get it. Nothing they can do about it right now. Just got to focus on getting 7 yards here.
3rd and 7, 13 minutes, 14 seconds in regulation. Bears at the Cards, 18. Trying to stretch this one out even more. Another dumper, this one to Kopecky, but he's not going to gain anything.
Nothing for Kopecky there, but it looked promising. I mean, like we said, Kopecky, when he gets the hands on his ball, it could be a threat. And there he goes, trying to do a tight end screen, but it's swallowed up immediately by the defense.
Bears are going to lose 3 yards.
The field goal unit is out here for the Bears. Field goal unit looks a lot like their punting unit, but this is the field goal unit.
Shane Drake looking for three. He hits 71.4% of his field goals. 5 for 7 on the year coming into today.
Make it
call
six
it 6 for 8.
Hey.
3 points. And I mean, Shane Drake extends the lead a little bit further. 31-21 Bears.
I mean, that was a very good kick. I mean, last season, the Bears weren't as good at kicking field goals as they are this year. And they only attempted two and didn't make either of them. That was last season. This season, they've made 6 off of 8 attempts, at least just for Shane Drake. So, you know, it's been a good season for him. Totally better than it was last year.
12:24 to go in regulation. Bears 31, Cardinals 21. Drake is back out to kick. Hansen deep for the Cardinals, but so too is a new character. Specifically, Derek Akins. Derek Akins, the tight end. A lot of talk about the versatility of tight ends. How about kick returning?
Absolutely. I mean, these guys are, they can do it all. That's what you want from these players, be versatile.
Bears lead it by 10. Drake Drake the boot. And that one's going to slide right past Hansen for the touchback.
Drake's got a leg on him. This kid could kick it to the moon if he wanted to, I'm pretty sure.
That doesn't get you any points.
Yeah, but, I mean, it looks cool. Unless the moon is in the uprights, then it might get you some points.
It's all about perspective. That sounds like a folk tale. That sounds like the kind of thing I would have read in fourth grade. In a good way.
In a great way, yeah.
Bears are going to start out on their own 25.
Jaren Alves.
Or correction, Cardinals are going to start out on their own 25.
Jaren Alves at the bottom of your screen on two receivers there.
Play action. Casares tries to air it out.
That's great coverage by the Bears. That's number 29. That's going to be... Oh, man. I know his name.
Medeiros.
Medeiros, yes. I know.
Brandon Medeiros. You would think we'd remember him after he had two interceptions last week against Mass Maritime in the Cranberry Bowl. He put on a defensive clinic last Saturday.
Yes, I should have remembered also because it's a very Portuguese-sounding name. I should remember that.
Portuguese is a state of mind, if you ask me. Second and 10 for the Cards from the 25. Casares wants another pass play, and this one's going to work a little bit more conservatively, but also a little bit more successfully to Andrew Camo.
And here we see, again, that was it's a solid play. I mean, like I said before, screen passes work when they're called at the right time. That was the right time to call a screen. Gets a nice big chunk of yardage there.
He picked up four.
Makes the third down and long, but still manageable. You gotta assume that's four down territory the rest of this game.
When they're down 10 and less than 12 minutes to go, they gotta be. Third and six. Casares, he's really thinking all pass now. That one's to Akins. Akins trying to put on the footwork. He's gonna fall down. Will they give him the first down? You could really kind of make a convincing case either way. That one was close at least.
And they're giving it to him.
They're gonna say, yes, he did.
I mean, I think it was definitely risky. He should have just taken the yards, but he jukes out and then gets tackled. He could have probably juked forward and got a few more. Secured that first down. That was very iffy.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. And a fresh set of downs from the 35.
Pass swallowed up.
Hand off to Camo. And he's going to pick up four.
Camo's had a couple of carries so far in this game. They've been pretty solid. This one... still pretty good. It was a 4-yard carry. 4 yards every time will get you a first down.
Camo averages 1.9 yards a rush, 2.6 rushing yards a game. That was a lot more than that, I think.
Absolutely.
Second and six, under 11 to play in the game, and the Bears think that the Cardinals moved. We could have a false start.
Heather. False start. Intercept one offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Cardinals coaches do not like that one bit. I saw pure disappointment from one of their faces.
No one's quite able to keep their hands and heads on their side of the line of scrimmage in this game. And the Cards are going to move back a few. Second and 11.
Hard count. Again.
Casares, thinking pass, thinking big airtime, wants something serious, gets it. What a huge shot to Jeffrey, deep into Bridgewater State territory.
Preston Jeffrey is an elite receiver for this team. I think they're in hurry up right now. They're going to try to call another play. They're probably going to get down before this replay is over.
Preston Jeffrey with a touchdown under his belt on the day already. Moves it all the way down to the BSU 18.
Yeah, carry here.
Hand off again to Camo, and he gets swallowed up after a couple.
That was a rough tackle there. It was forced down. Almost kind of looked like it could have been a face mask, but it wasn't. They grabbed onto him and pulled him down right here. Second and eight. Yeah, grabbed on right in front. That's a legal tackle.
He was swallowed up. That was the work of Brian Campagna on the stop there, though. Under 10 to play in the game. Second and eight at the BSU 16. Casares wanted a handoff. No such luck. Bears thought the ball might have come out. What a huge, huge ouchie delivered by Lewis Casey.
I kind of missed what happened there, but that was a great great tackle by Casey. He's just getting the ball on the ground. He gets.
And Lewis Casey gives him the Muhammad Ali.
They get back up.
They lose three, third and 12 from the Bridgewater State 20. And this drive is starting to unfold much differently than Nico Casares intended. Looking for a pass, gets it to Akins. Akins trying to slide his way through.
That gives him the first.
Under nine to go. And it's going to be first and goal to go.
You underestimate the effect that tight ends can have on these college teams, but you know, we've seen from Kopecky and Akins that they can make or break a game for their plays.
First and goal to go from the Bridgewater six. Under 9 minutes to play. Bears lead by 10. He wants to change that, and that one's right off the fingertips. So close and yet so far for Cornaccione.
That is just excellent coverage there. I mean, it was like a blanket. I don't think there was any way he comes down with that. It's excellent coverage there by number 40, Steven Sylvia, the defensive player of the year for the Mascots.
He's playing like it for sure. Second and goal to go. Cardinals want to figure something out. Crowd is imploring the Bears defense to keep an eye on Akins. Casares in the air and throws that one well away.
Closest player on the field to that ball was Jaron Alves, but you know, Alves unable to make a play on that. He wanted to. It would have been probably his fourth interception of the year. He's very good at getting interceptions.
Third and goal to go.
It is loud in this at Swenson Field today. You can see how much the camera was shaking with all the stomping the crowd is doing.
Not to mention our sound system. 8:24 in the game. Third and goal to go for Nico Casares and company. Down by 10. Casares. And that was slick coverage by Mr. Sylvia.
I believe that was number 43 for the Bears. That's going to be Cody Sautome.
Sylvia in the neighborhood. Sautome, however, managed to nearly get a piece of it. Just look at that.
I
saw 4 and then the right side of the number and thought it was 4-0. It was instead 4-3. Slick work by Cody Sautome on the stop. And he's going to hold the Cardinals to a field goal attempt.
It's a great stop by the Bears defense. Keep them to 3. You bend but don't break. You got them all the way down into your, well into the 5-yard line, I believe, on first down. And they were able to convert that, which excellent defensive stand by the Bears.
Sautome with a big play on third down. Cardinals are able, with the help of Fabrizio Riley, to make it a one-score game, but they find themselves on the wrong side of that, 31-24. Just over 8 minutes to play in the game.
Barring any sort of miracle kickoff or onside kick, you're going to get the ball back to James Cahoon, who can score on you before you even notice what's happened. But
the CUA defense is in a big spot here, one of their final chances to really slow down the Bridgewater State momentum.
The Catholic has been able to show that, you know, this defense goes out without fight. They've been able to make this game very interesting. Every time they go down, they manage to tie it up somehow. So we'll see what's going to happen with this in this drive.
Gilzine, Tucker, and Carpenter deep for the Bears. And kicking it away this time is Connor Gill. Gilzine Tucker rolls up around the 30. People flying everywhere.
You know, Bridgewater is listed as having one of the best game day atmospheres in the state. It was a few weeks back, but you know, I think it could be said every week. You know, with the Bridgewater comes in with the same amount of force and energy every day every week, and you know the fans are here to hear the Mascot energy too.
It's good vibes here at Swenson Field on the campus of Bridgewater State University. Bears going to start between their own 30 and 31. 8 to go in the game. Calhoun looking for a pass. First things first, gets it to Nocera. And he picks up a few, but he's bottled up in quite forceful fashion by Carson Henry.
That was a big hit. I do not envy Nocera at all. It just, he takes all of it. It's a massive hit. He's lucky he held on to that. So I would not have been able to.
Carson Henry, the linebacker from Port Jervis, New York. Right with that run and a first down. Slick carry, and he's going to pick up 12 or 13. Or correction, move it 12 or 13 away from the line of scrimmage. Pick up probably about 8.
That is just a good run. Breaks tackles and then starts to put the juke moves in and still manages to fall forward. That's a great play. That's what you want from your running backs.
Those two are a unit that have been working in perfect concert all afternoon. They're going to try to do it again. Wright's going to slide his way through the gut. He's still going, and he gets probably 8 or 9. What a run by Isaiah Wright.
Isaiah Wright was carrying the defender with him. I don't even know who that defender was. He was carrying it with him. His Bears in the hurry-up offense. It's number 10 for Catholic.
Carson Henry, 230 pounds, and Wright just carries him.
That's short. I believe it's going to be short of the first down yardage for Wright, but that was a solid run if he was able to get the blocks there. Torres missed a key block.
Nearly eaten by Aiden Long on the play there. Another New Yorker.
Torres unable to get the block there. Bears able to get the first down. It brings up third and short.
6.5 to go in the game. Bears up 7. Cardinals are trying to lay down the pain. Calhoun, another handoff.
And that's short again.
And that goes nowhere. Number 34, Dimitri on the carry. That was Greg Dimitri, who has a touchdown today. Couldn't conjure up the same success on that run. And the Bears are going to punt it away.
That is not what you wanted to see if you were a Bears fan or a Bears player or a Bears coach. If you were interested in the Bears at all, that is not what you wanted to see. You know, you had second and short, and then third and short, and now you're at fourth and short, and you have to punt it.
If you're a fan of Shane Drake, however, you are probably pumped right now.
Like I said, he kicked it to the moon, which is helpful for punting. Not always, but usually it's helpful when you can punt to the moon.
Ditto if you're a fan of Malachi Hansen out back for the Cardinals. That one's going to fall, and Bears are going to pin Catholic quite deep.
Wow. Those Shane Drake
sensational
fans.
Punt by Shane Drake, making the best of a crummy situation.
Those Shane Drake fans, they know what they're on. That's a good player.
Catholic poised to start at their own 2. 5:11 to play in regulation. Bears lead it by 7, but Catholic has a chance to rewrite things if they can make it out of their own red zone.
It's going to be exciting to watch, especially if Catholic can make it all the way down the field, score a touchdown, and tie it up, and possibly even take the lead with a 2-play conversion.
Cassara is starting in his own end zone. Not usually a harbinger of great things to come. He's going to air this one out. For Akins, it's intended, but it falls short. I was going to say he was followed around by Medeiros on the play.
Didn't quite have the power there for that one. Almost stepping out of the back of the end zone, but it was just great coverage by Medeiros there. I didn't forget his name this time. Didn't forget it this time. I know it now.
You're going to know it after coverage like that. 2nd and 10 from their own 2-yard line for the Cardinals. Just over 5 minutes to play in regulation.
They've brought the trophy down to the field on the sideline.
The hardware has escaped the press box. I didn't even get to take a picture with it. 2nd and 10 from the 2. This one's a little bit more conservative and more successful.
That was the first down.
Hansen, the Philadelphian, prone to do that. You might guess he knows something about football.
No, Phillies.
Being from the city of brotherly love.
Phillies had a good year in sports this year, so, you know, maybe she's showing up for him.
For the sake of broadcast rules, I'll get no more specific than that. He picks up the first down. Dumps that one off with Camo, and he'll chew up three or four.
I mean, they're getting down the field slowly but surely. You know, you don't want to do it too quickly, because if you score a touchdown, you can tie up the game. The Bears have time to respond.
And so you have to consider also, not only is this only a one-score game, but the Cardinals have all three of their timeouts. It's not life or death right now. They just have to be careful.
A turnover would really cost them. They need to score a touchdown in this drive. No matter when they do it.
Second and six, big space. Whoa!
Great coverage by Jaren Alves there.
John Means thought catch. Jaren Alves thought nope.
This is Jaren Alves' field. He's not going to let you get anything out of it.
Jaren Alves said take that one back to the district. And with under four to go, it's third and six from their own 17. For Catholic University, crowds feeling it. Big moment. Casares, space.
Short of the first down.
Who else broke it up? Jaren Alves, preventing danger, and it's fourth and six.
That is an awesome play by Alves, and I believe it's a catch. They're giving it to him.
No.
It pops out. That is not a catch.
That was intended for Shane Paul. Keyword intended. Jaren Alves with two huge breakups in two plays.
What a great game so far by Alves.
Catholic University offense with little choice but to stay on the field and try to stick it out on fourth and six. And
you can see on the camera how loud it is today. These fans are into it.
3:48 to go in the game.
Timeout is called. That's a great... That's not a great use of the timeout there, but I mean, if they can convert this, that's behind them. It's behind them. They can just keep going. They can convert this fourth down. If not, give the Bears plenty of time to just waste it and possibly even score and well into their own territory.
Jaren Alves with two huge, huge defensive plays for Bridgewater State on that one. It's just really been a great show. As much as CUA has been able to get done today, and they really have, they've put up 24 points on these Bears. When it's coming into the clutch, these moments like this, guys like Jaren Alves, guys all over this Bridgewater State defense, have been making huge clutch plays to keep this thing from getting out of hand.
Absolutely. I mean, they're able to score at any moment. And then you also have the Cardinals. They're punching it now, it looks like.
Cardinals got scared. Gill will punt it away, and now Bridgewater State will take a timeout, which is creative. What the heck are you going to do, ice the punter? You're going to ice the punter?
I mean, it's Jaren Alves, the man, the myth, the legend, but, you know, he's been making great plays, and he's the reason they're considering even punting at this moment right now.
Bridgewater State head coach Joe Varia is sufficiently scared of Connor Gill as to call his second time out of the second half. 3:48 to go in regulation here at Swenson Field. Bears lead it 31-24. Catholic University seemingly about to punt away what may have been their last truly great chance to tie this thing up.
It's definitely very questionable to punt it when you've been in worse situations and you've gone for it anyways.
Gill's average punt is 38.4 yards. Oh, he threw it, and it's an interception!
Nearly a pick six, but I knew there was going to be something up with that play.
Connor Gill, fake punt. Guess his throwing's not as good as his kicking, and he delivers one right into the hands of the defensive back, Matthew Mamone, the sophomore from Dedham. Holy smokes!
I don't want to sound like LeBron James right now, but I feel like I knew something was going to come up with that. I knew it was going to be a trick play of some sort. It was a great play there by the defense of the Bears.
Matthew Mamone picks up his second interception of the season. And what a time to do it, man. 3:41 to go in regulation. Bears are taking over first and 10 from the Cardinals 11 with an opportunity to put this one out of reach.
Hand off to Wright goes nowhere.
An extra yardage was out of reach for Isaiah Wright. Bears are going to lose a couple on that one.
I mean, Wright has been, he's proving himself today. He's proven to Coach Varia and his teammates that he can, you know, I believe it's Adam Couch's last year on the roster. He's on senior night. He was celebrating with a team.
And
so
he's hurt today.
Potentially, he could be done for the Bears, and it's going to be Isaiah Wright's team for the next few years.
Just about 3 minutes to go in regulation, and the Bears are on the better end of it, 31-24. Second and 13 from the Cardinals, 14. Cahoon, another handoff to Wright. And he's going to try to move a little bit more slickly, but he'll just escape back to the original line of scrimmage at the 11.
I mean, again, this is another great run by Wright. He's refused to go down. I think you can put him in contention as MVP for this game if the Bears are able to win this.
Third and 10. At absolute worst, Bridgewater State. Well, that's not true. There are a lot of absolute worsts. But the conventional absolute worst would be being pressed into a field goal to make this a 10-point game yet again.
Or a turnover. I mean, especially you get this close.
That's what I was thinking was the cataclysmic absolute worst. Third and 10. Cahoon looking for a pass play. He's in danger. Has to toss it and misses everyone. He gets a heck of a lot of pressure from Luke Brautigan, who just steps out there and scares him away.
Unable to connect it with Kyle Torres there. And definitely, I mean, not questionable if it's complete, but definitely questionable call to pass it when you can just get this down to the two-minute warning. Well, there's no two-minute warning. I apologize.
I can tell you, if I had 220 pounds of Luke Brautigan running at me like that, I would do exactly the same thing. So they are indeed going to go for three instead. Shane Drake looking to make this one double digits yet again. And that's exactly what he'll do.
It's good, and he keeps it. He gives a lead for the Bears here. It's a 10-point game for the Bears. And, you know, Catholic is going to need to respond fast. They're going to need a quick score, a quick turnover, another quick score if they want to win this again.
They got 120 seconds to do it. At the two-minute warning, Shane Drake has made this a 10-point game.
This has been an excellent game to watch. I mean, if you're a fan of either team, you're just a spectator, or you're a parent of one of these athletes, you're happy about this.
Oh, of course. No matter what the final is here today at Swenson Field, make no mistake, both of these units have played their absolute hearts and souls out.
And they've made Mother happy at home.
Drake to kick it off. Out deep for the Cardinals. Hanson and Akins. Thirty-four, 24 Bears.
You see the trophy that's going to be given out to these teams at the end of the day. Some nice hardware.
And inside that black box, the little flat black box, is the special silver plate for this game's MVP. Hanson's going to let that one roll into the end for a touchback. Cardinals will start from their own 25 with 120 seconds to make a whole lot of magic.
I mean, it would certainly make it interesting if they're able to, but I think, you know, I'm not going to call it game. I'm never going to be the one to do it, you know, especially in this region of the United States. We know that game isn't over until there's zeros on the clock.
Nico Casares, thanks you very much for that confidence. Him and his offensive unit looking to put 10 points on the board in 120 seconds.
Even for Bridgewater. I'll get back to that thought at this play.
Kassar is immediately looking air. Drops it to Akins. Akins scampering up, and he's going to get that first down. He'll go down at the Cardinals 44, but they got to hurry on up because the clock is still rolling. At least it's supposed to be. Clock is stopped at 151 right now on the field here, and now it's rolling. Casares in trouble trying to get something else, and that's incomplete.
All right. Casares is pass intent for number 22. As I was trying to say earlier, the Bears team, this women's basketball team, a few weeks ago, had a 20-point lead going into the fourth quarter. At the end of the game, only a 1-point win for the Bears. So anything is definitely possible.
And last night, they laid the smackdown on Wellesley. I was at that game in the Tinsley Center just next door here. Second and 10 for the Cardinals from their own 44. Casares trying to run it himself. He's in danger, taken down by a couple different pairs of arms. One of which belonging, little surprise, to Brian Campagna. And the other belonging, even less surprise, to Dan Cataldo.
That's going to be the final timeout for the Catholic today. I have one more. I lost track.
Bears have one timeout. CUA had two. They've just used their first of those two.
It's hard to keep track of these timeouts sometimes in these close games.
A minute 33 to go in regulation. Bears up 10. And that was a big stop on second down right there by Cataldo and Campagna. Going to be looking at third and 9 when we get back onto the field here. There's Bears head coach Joe Varia, whose unit has been working expertly so far this afternoon. That's him without the hat on. Whole lot of coaches in the shot there. I want to make sure I'm describing the right guy. Third and 9 from the 45 for the Cardinals. Nico Casares on a wing and a prayer. Putting it in space, drops it off with Camo. He can't get first down yardage.
I expected that to be first down yardage. He had green grass. He had one defender to beat. The defender made a great play there.
And this time, as they set up, clock still rolling. A minute 12. Casares. That one's batted down.
And that is a turnover on downs. And
Lewis Casey got a piece of that one. What a huge play.
That might have just iced the game out for the Bears. But again, never say never. I'm not leaving out a chance for a miracle to happen. It is just very unlikely for it to happen. That's why they're called miracles.
Lewis Casey, with the biggest touch of his BSU career to date, turns the Cardinals over on downs. And that's going to be all she wrote.
They're getting the trophy prepared for the winner of this team, winner of this game, which is potentially looking to be the Bears.
A minute 7 left, but it's pretty much all paperwork at this point. Bears lead by 10, and I'd be stunned if they don't kneel these out.
And it looks like they are doing so. James Cahoon with the first kneel down. That's going to be the timeout called. I mean, you have timeouts, you use them. You have three timeouts, might as well use all three.
Catholic says, what the heck, let's take a breather before we proceed. But it's going to be in the books. Bears are up 10, and it's presumably going to stay that way. So the first time ever that these two programs have met, and I mean ever, and Bridgewater State, despite a very closely fought game, we talked about how hard both of these teams have worked, how competitive both of them have been. But Bridgewater State leaving their mark on the Catholic University Cardinals in the first ever meeting between these two programs, that's got to set a really, really great tone for this Bears program.
Absolutely. You know, the Bears came into this game. They've had a great season, but so have the Catholic. The Cardinals, they've done very great this season. It's... You know, the Bears were just the better team today. The better team usually ends up being the one who wins. But both teams have put up a very big fight, a very good fight.
Bears outdid the Cardinals in yards today, 419 to 350. Averaged a yard more per play, more really, than the Cardinals did. They've just really, as competitive as both of these teams have been, Bears were able to get the edge they needed and again cement themselves as one of the better units in Division III football.
Absolutely, and I mean, you know, the Bears, have been very solid all year. And I think it's worth noting that after his performance today, if Jim Kuhn plays next year, he could potentially come the passing leader in both touchdowns and yards for the Bears all time, which is very impressive.
They came from Washington, D.C., and they'll head back without a victory. Bridgewater State, in the first ever meeting between these two programs, defeats the Catholic University of America Cardinals 34-24 and comes away with a huge New England Bowl victory.
This is the second time the Bears have won the New England Bowl. You know, I think the Cardinals are just grateful to be even able to play in a bowl game. This is their first bowl game since 2008, and none of these players on this roster were playing in that game. That was how long ago it was. So it's I think you just got to be grateful you even have a chance to be in this game. You know, having the success you had in the regular season, and just being able to play this bowl game.
And there's Mr. Cahoon himself, number 12. In what may be one of his last, if not his last, game at Bridgewater State University, but boy, did he make the most of it.
If it's not his last year, he's got next year, and he can set some records for the Bears. And he deserves it. He's a hard player. He goes hard every time. He fights every game, and he's got some soul to him.
And thinking about, you know, fighting, we've talked all day about the real hard work that both of these teams have had to put in to adapt to conditions that have changed around them due to injuries. We talked about Nico Casares, who started at quarterback, played the whole game at quarterback for the Cardinals today, who got his starting job because of an injury to his predecessor there, Dowd. And he was able to perform really expertly. He actually picked up more yardage than Cahoon did. 256 yards for Nico Casares, the Miami native today, compared to 249 for Cahoon. It was hard fought. And then the same as well for the Bears on the running back game, without Couch, without Pointer. And Isaiah Wright comes through in the clutch, just a sophomore, and is able to leave his mark on this game.
You know, Casares, Mr. 305, he came in the start of the season as a third-string quarterback. And he won his conference first, made his conference all first team, or first team all New Mac conference team, which is very impressive. It's a very good story to tell your grandchildren one day.
MASCAC Assistant Commissioner Emily Liu and New Mac Assistant Director Taylor Texera.
New Mac and MASCAC bosses or co-bosses. Top brass meeting on the field right now for the presentation.
This year's New England Football Bowl
we'll take it to the
MVP
PA here.
From Bridgewater State University, quarterback James Cahoon. And now, with the team captains from Bridgewater State University, please come forward to accept the New England Football Bowl Championship Trophy.
Bears with a New England Bowl victory, and they did it their way at home. Your final score, Bears 34, Catholic University of America Cardinals 24. Thank you so much for joining us here on the Bears Sports Network on BTV for the 2022 New England Bowl. I'm Matt Donahue.
And I have been David Souza.
We'll see you next time around here on the Bears Sports Network. And remember that every day is
a great day
to be a
Bear.
Peace to you all, folks. We'll see you next time.